concerned with what we have learned over the last 40 years from a vast body of research into the management of innovation to help find new and better ways of improving the human condition. Many of us are involved or will be involved in helping others. And I'm going to argue in this lecture that these studies of the management of innovation can help you to do a better job. In effect, I'm going to argue that what we've learned largely outside of the helping professionals actually is a methodology, a technology, a set of constructs, a set of tools, a set of ways of thinking, a set of ways of being, which is important to those of us who are teachers, to missionaries, to people who are counselors, coaches, anyone involved in working to improve the quality of life for the greatest number. Now, I'm going to spend the first half of my lecture, perhaps 15 minutes or so, giving you a structured insight into innovation management. This is what we have learned since the study first began, round about 40 years ago, as to what it takes for an organization to come up with and implement more and better ideas and create value from them. And I'm going to do this to give you a platform of understanding. Some of you may not be aware that there is such a study as innovation management. And in order to present to you the value of this study for you, I need you to understand some of the basics. And then I'm going to give you a case study. And this case study, because we are in an academic environment, I'm going to explore some aspects of innovation within academic institutions. Hopefully that will help you to see the relevance, and it will also give me an opportunity to explain to you how innovation is not just something that we might like to have within a university, a college, a school. It's something which is mission critical to future strategy. So, the purpose of my lecture is to give you an insight into this field of innovation management. But more importantly, I want you to recognize something which perhaps is not included in every aspect of academia. And that is, we as individuals, we as groups and teams, we as teachers, we as managers, we as missionaries, we need to be actively involved in innovation ourselves. It's not something which is just an academic study, it is a way of life. So, let's look at the background of innovation management. This stone tool was actually found not very far away in South Africa, and it's 160,000 years old. So what is special about this stone tool? It is a scraper, it's used for getting meat off the bone, perhaps for building shelters, and this kind of thing. But what is unique about this tool, in terms of tools which are similar, which were found in South Africa, is this tool is sharper, it works better, it's more efficient and effective, and the reason why it's more efficient and effective is that this tool was made using an engineering process. As far as archaeology tells us, in fact, now, this is the oldest and the first example of technological innovation known to man. As I said, it's not too far away. So, What needs to happen for the person who is making this proposal? The process is called napping. What needs to happen if the napper is going to create this superior tool? Well, the stone has to be heated to approximately 350 degrees centigrade for about 3 hours. And then the chemical composition of the tool is changed so that it becomes much more effective, so that it can be worked more easily. You cannot actually create the sharpness of these edges unless you heat treat the stone first. So our ancestors, 160,000 years ago, found a technological process for actually reliably making these stone tools using heat treatment. So let's just think about what needed to be done. Well, imagine it's a situation 160,000 years ago. Someone who is skilled in making these tools, a stone tool napper, takes the stone perhaps from a fire. There was a fire last night. Maybe she or he was too lazy to go to the normal pit where they got the stones. And he starts to work. And he finds, oh, it's sharper. I can get better edges. It's easier to work. It's faster. And then something magical happens. This man, woman, feels that this is not just something which is, oh, maybe the cat slept on the stone, so it's easier to work. He feels that there is a potential. He realizes that there is an opportunity which can be taken further forward. It kind of swims out from the background that there's a chance to do something new and different here. And what this particular man or woman has done is to capture and make real an opportunity. He's seen an opportunity and there's enough energy there to actually transform that energy into a drive to move forward, to make a difference. But we don't know why the stone was easier to work. Yes, it came from by the fire, but perhaps it was a superior stone. Perhaps there was some magic involved. Perhaps some primitive force had inhabited the stone and made it easier to work. We don't know. There are lots of unknowns. So the opportunity needed to be explored and studied, just as a detective studies how a criminal case is working and all the facts. So someone had to dig deep. She or he had to analyze the potential of the opportunity. Maybe they took stones. They put some sign on them. They put them in a fire for 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours. They put them in hot fires and less hot fires and then tried to nap them. They performed experiments. They got to know inside of the process what was actually happening, when it happened, how it happened, where the advantages lay, what was involved in actually making it happen. So this is the second phase in innovation management. Not just having an idea or seeing an opportunity, but digging deeply into it to understand its potential. In effect, to understand its costs and the opportunities, what's involved in making it work, and to get some sense of the possible value.